Mykola prayed for a long time. Then he picked up a briefcase and removed several papers from it. He tossed the rest into the fire. After crossing himself, he returned to his bed and cried uncontrollably. On the night of February 12, 1852, writer Mykola Hohol burned the second volume of his unique novel, Dead Souls. No one before or after Mykola Hohol could depict Ukrainian life in Russian as extensively, convincingly, vividly and excitingly as he did. Hundreds of millions of readers around the world learned about Ukraine through his sensational novel. He made his readers fall in love with the people, language, customs and traditions. The writer was admired by George Simenon, Alberto Moravia, Ibrahim Hilmi. His writings were translated into almost all the languages of the planet. The outstanding Ukrainian writer became the founder of the so-called natural literary school, and his prose inspired great composers and artists of all times. Today, Mykola, we're having guests once again. Indeed, it is quite rare when we're not having them. These days, they come rushing like a flood, just like in the good old days when you came to visit the village. Just note that the years and centuries pass by quickly, but the interest to your personality, not to mention the creative aspect, remains the same. Veliky Sorochinsky in Poltava region. Every August, on the outskirts of the village, preparations for the world-famous fair are in full swing. This tradition dates back to the 16th century. Back then, merchants from many cities of Central and Western Europe came to Ukraine. They brought exquisite jewelry, decorations and household items for sale. In return, they bought leather, horns, wool, grain, fat and honey made in Ukraine. It was in Veliky Sorochinsky that a boy was born into a family of middle-class landowners on March 20, 1809. Mykola was the third child born into the large Yanovsky family. His childhood passed in the family estate, now the village of Hoholeve. His father, Vasil Opanasovich, died when his son was just over 15 years old. It is believed that it was the artistic nature of the father, a person of cheerful disposition and a highly talented writer, that influenced the creative nature of the young Hohol. Later, Mykola called himself Hohol Yanovsky. After that, he retained only the first part of his surname. It was associated with the stately golden-eyed duck, which waddled slowly on dry land, with its chest sticking out and its head thrown back, as if playing an important role. The house of the family was small, but there was always lard, sauerkraut, and homemade liquors in the cellar that writer's mother, Maria Ivanovna, prepared based on her personal recipes. Along the line of his grandmother from his father's side, Mykola Hohol was associated with noble Cossack families of Ukraine. He is considered a descendant of the interim Hetman Mihailo Doroshenko and right bank Hetman Petro Doroshenko, as well as a descendant of interim Hetman Yakiv Lizahub and left bank Hetman Ivan Skoropadsky. Mykola could spend hours with his grandmother. She would talk about everything with him, in particular about the past lives of the Cossacks. She taught him to use medicinal herbs. She sang him classical folk songs, which he loved a lot. He really loved Ukrainian folk songs. Mykola often listened to all kinds of grandmother's mystical stories. One of them was about the stairs that took the souls of the dead to heaven. That image firmly lodged in the boy's mind and memory. Stairs of various kinds would appear now and then on the pages of Hohol's works. Mykola spent his childhood on picturesque Ukrainian lands that were shrouded in the Cossack past. Ancient history, folk legends, and the national romanticism of Ukraine. Do you know a Ukrainian night? No, you do not know a night in Ukraine. The moon shines in the midst of the sky. The immeasurable vault of heaven seems to have expanded to infinity. The earth is bathed in silver light. The air is warm, voluptuous, and redolent of innumerable sweet scents. A divine night. A magical night. The young man was surrounded by various people. Simple peasants, Cossacks, Chumaks, merchants, sharp-tongued girls, and cheerful guys. He had been absorbing folk legends since his childhood. For example, there were legends about witches, mermaids, and a fern that only blooms one night on Ivan Kupala or St. John's Eve. Poltava. Here the young Hohol went on walks admiring the bands of Warskla. He often came to the cathedral square when he returned for the weekend from the Nizhyn Higher Applied Sciences High School in the Chernihiv region. He was a mediocre student, according to his classmates. However, he was known as a cheerful young man, and when he got up on stage, he made the audience of the school theater burst out laughing. His impressions of funny old men and women were especially good. Dreaming of a career, Mykola went to Petersburg. Back then, children of many known families from Ukraine were forced to try their luck in the capital of the Russian Empire. Otherwise, they would have wasted their knowledge in the rural backwoods of Ukraine. City on the Neva, epoch of Tsar Nicholas I of Russia, the years of economic and political stagnation, but also the time of great balls and cultural flourishing. Mykola dreamt of becoming the Minister of Justice in Petersburg, or at least a tailor. "I know a lot of crafts," the young man claimed. By the way, he was engaged in sewing since his childhood. He tailored his own handkerchiefs and waistcoats, and sometimes he even sewed dresses for his sisters. So much in this room reminds of him. In addition to his literary hobbies, he also had a huge passion for needlework. He was better at embroidering than his sisters. He came up with the styles of their dresses himself. He drew the models, cut the fabric, and sewed dresses with his own hands. That was why his sisters were looking forward to his return to their native village. Cruel disappointment was waiting for the young conqueror of Petersburg. His modest funds melted away in the big city just like his hopes for a quick and brilliant career. However, he also had plenty of determination and craftiness in reserve. He also tried to get a place on the stage, become an official, and take up literature. But he didn't get the position of an actor, and legal service was so scarce that it started to weigh him down. As for a literary career, Mykola hadn't considered that option for a while. His first experience scared him too much. At the age of 20, having just arrived at the capital, he invested all the money his mother gave to him in the publication of the poem of his youth about romantic ideals called Hans Kuchelgarten. It was unsuccessful and truly childish. He published it under the pseudonym V. Alof. Poetry turned out to be not one of the Hohol's elements. He panicked after the attack of critics. The poor man ran from bookstore to bookstore until he bought all 600 copies of the ill-fated poem. For the following 3 days, he used those to stoke the oven in a rented apartment, thus writing and completing the first but not last literary auto-da-fé in his lifetime. At some point, Mykola firmly decided to stop with his eccentricities and enter the service. His family connections were sufficiently good enough for him to get a position of, well, not the Minister of Justice, but a scribe in the land plot department. Then, with his chin up against the hard collar of his uniform, Mykola wrote like a madman for pennies. He became one of the jacksnouts that he later portrayed in the stories of his Petersburg series. He did it well. He spoke Ukrainian really well, very well. And when he comes to our village, he doesn't say a single word in Russian. He called it a foreign language. He wrote me from Petersburg, "Mother, I have to write in a foreign language here." And I thought to myself, he doesn't know English that well. And the same was with the French language. As it turned out, he called Russian a foreign language. Not great Russian, not Russian, but foreign to him. Finally, Mykola decided to repeat his attempt and give his works for the public to judge. As soon as his evenings on a farm near Dikanka saw the light of the day, Hohol's destiny and future took a turn for the better. Those stories were truly fantastic and captivated the readers instantly. He created the image of the steppe Ukraine, a generous land of cheerful people and full of legends, sometimes funny like the story The Fair at Sorochensy, and sometimes creepy like St. John's Eve. These days, the settlement of Dikanka is very different to what it was at the time of Hohol. However, a small church of the 17th century still remains in one's memory. Allegedly, the protagonist of the mystical story V. Homa Brut read psalms over the corpse of a girl who could turn into a black cat. Hohol's works started being translated into many foreign languages. Composers wrote several operas based on the plots of the writer, for example, Christmas Eve by composer Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov and Cherevichki by Pyotr Tchaikovsky. From a young age, Hohol studied all the historical literature about Ukraine available to him. He was most interested in the history of the Zaporizhian siege, Khmelnytsky uprising, the Ruin era, the rule of Ivan Mazepa and the abolition of the Hetmanate. What was the goal of the writer when referring to the times when Ukraine was struggling for the right to national independence? On the pages of manuscripts, the writer reflected on the events that took place in Ukraine and admire the very strong and unflinching characters of the Zaporizhian Cossacks. Back when he was 20 years old, Hohol planned a grandiose work dedicated to the history of his native land. Now I've started working on the history of our poor Ukraine. Nothing else calms me the way that history does. My thoughts flow more quietly and with more order. I think I'll write about it, and I'll tell a lot of what hadn't been told before I appeared on the scene as a writer. Hohol placed an announcement in several periodicals in 1834 about the publication of the History of Little Russia, which is how Ukraine was called under the regime of Tsarist Russia. He asked to send him various materials, notes, chronicles, songs. In his work, Hohol wanted to present in detail how the people, the Cossacks, came to be, marked by the complete originality of character and feats, how they had been fighting for their rights and defending their religion, with weapons and arms, for three centuries. The writer invariably interpreted the fate of Ukraine in the context of the entire world history. However, the same fate as the first publication of the writer, the poem Hans Kuchelgarten, befell the manuscript of the History of Ukraine. It was licked from existence by the tongues of the fire element. According to Hohol, the work turned out incomplete and subpar. Alas, nobody knows the real reason behind that. In October 1835, Hohol told the Russian poet Alexander Pushkin, "I started writing Dead Souls. The plot has stretched out into a long novel, and I think will end up ridiculous. In this novel, I intend to show the entire history of Rus from one point of view, at the very least." Hohol cautiously read the first chapters of his new work to Pushkin, expecting them to incite in him laughter. But the poet's expression darkened and he uttered, "God, how sad our Russia is!" In 1836, the sensational premiere of the play The Government Inspector took place. Needless to say, the officials of Petersburg were outraged, while people of miscellaneous ranks loved it. Ibrahim Hilmi, who translated the play into Turkish, admitted in the 1940s that Hohol's comedy was very relevant for Turkish reality. That is also evidenced by the fact that in 1948, the Turkish government banned The Government Inspector in Ankara. The Viennese newspaper, Wiener Zeitung, pointed to the importance of Hohol's comedy when the play premiered in Austria in 1979. In the 1950s, the comedy Inspector Incognito, directed against resurgent fascism, appeared in Italy. Hohol's satire is not at all obsolete. On the contrary, it turned out to be relevant in the modern world, as the Italian writer Alberto Moravia wrote. After the premiere of The Government Inspector, Russian Tsar Nikolai I said, "Everyone got what they deserved, most of all me." The words of the autocrat were not condemning, but Hohol got frightened for some reason. The writer hastily went to leave and continued his work abroad for a long 12 years. He was brilliantly talented. Yes, he suffered. He suffered there in a foreign land. First of all, this was because he was not valued for his works the way he wanted to be appreciated. Germany, Switzerland, Paris. Much later, the French writer Georges Simenon admitted that it was Mykola Hohol who had developed an interest in the rather eccentric topic of the little man in him. "I learned to penetrate the hidden drama of life, which can be crippled by the purely external and, at first glance, insignificant cause of Hohol. I learned and keep on learning from Hohol to give a tragic sound to the inconspicuous destinies of little people." His European tour continued, a bit of Geneva and then the path to the Eternal City. "If only you knew how glad I was to leave Switzerland and fly to my beloved and beautiful Italy. It's mine. Nobody in the world can take it away from me." From a letter to Zhukovsky. Rome. There's nothing in this world that could inspire the creative genius of Mykola Hohol more. Europe will amaze you from the first time you enter the gates of the first city. Picturesque houses, either above or below you, blue mountains, thick linden trees, ivy that carpets walls and fences together with grapevines. It is all wonderful and I like it. From a letter to Prokopovich.
А мне сказывал его очень близкий друг, пан Шевелев.
His close friend, Mr. Shevelyov, told me that when Mykola traveled in Europe and had to state his identity, he always wrote the following words wherever he was. Monsignor Mykola Hohol, a Ukrainian who lingered in Moscow. And this is one of the few places that remember the eminent Ukrainian. Café Greco in Rome was the writer's favorite place. He often met young artists who lived at the resort provided to them by the Petersburg Academy of Arts. The café was also a point of correspondence with the homeland. Perhaps images appeared at such cozy tables that helped Hohol continue writing his masterpiece Dead Souls. I started working on Dead Souls in Petersburg. I redid everything I knew, thought the whole plan through, and now working on it without haste, like a chronicle. What an expansive and original plot! The entire history of Rus will appear in it. This will be my first decent work. From a letter to Vasily Zhukovsky. The famous French writer Henri Troyat wrote about how Hohol worked on his novel Dead Souls in Rome. He wrote mostly in the morning, standing at his high music stand. Very soon, the sound breaking through the cracks of the shutters, the squabbling of neighbors, the shouts of merchants, and the bleating of goats made him want to go outside. Any pretext was enough for him to put the pen down. First of all, the importance of the work he undertook excluded any thoughts about haste in his mind. Longing for the house of his parents took him back to Ukraine. In his family house in Yanovshina in the Poltava region, Mykola continued working on the second part of the novel he began in Rome, Dead Souls. He hadn't left his wing of the house for weeks on end. The writer promised to impress everyone with his unique work. However, he hurried off to Petersburg yet again without finishing it. At the beginning of 1852, in serious doubt about the morality of his literary heritage and anticipating his death, Hohol met his spiritual mentor, Father Matvey Konstantinovsky. He advised to destroy the manuscript, saying that it had a detrimental effect on the writer's health. The priest insisted that Hohol should give up writing completely and become a monk, which would allegedly ease his emotional suffering. He would write to me from Petersburg. Mother, nobody must know my soul. He didn't entrust his secrets and personal interests even to his close friends. Many thought he was strange because of that. And then he once said, "Well, I'm strange, but pray tell, who among us is not strange?" Indeed, each of us has their own petty and strange peculiarities that others simply don't notice. Maybe those peculiar features of Mykola Hohol were more noticeable. After all, he was a brilliantly talented individual. The unknown disease struck the writer again in Moscow in the house of Count Alexander Tolstoy on Nikitsky Boulevard. Hohol spent 2 days without food and water. He spent hours praying in his small closed room. Fearing for the fate of the second volume of the novel Dead Souls, Hohol tried giving it to his benefactor, but Count Tolstoy refused to accept it. On the night of February 12, 1852, the feverish writer burned his manuscripts in a state of total frustration and even madness. Together with the papers, the flame consumed his meaning of life. The writer faded away in just a few days. He didn't talk to anybody. On February 21st, Mykola Hohol passed away. According to eyewitnesses, the last words of the writer were "ladder, quick, give me a ladder." Now, readers wandering among the funny and horrifying and seeing his faces and romance can only guess with horror what great drama ate away at the chest of this comedy writer. How did this peculiar man who laughs suffer? Hohol cursed his laughter in the name of the serious, and he especially burned the pages of his work to revive his soul from their ashes. Your admirers and scientists who can't solve the riddle of your talent keep coming to us. They keep struggling, but may God bless them. Let them continue trying to solve this unsolvable riddle of life. I'm considered a mystery to everyone. Nobody will understand me completely. Mykola Hohol.